Thank you very much, Sergio, for the introduction and not commenting on the affiliation. Not saying like Prince or not for long.
Well, I like the fact that you put it very
All right, all right. And okay, so I'd like to thank the organizers very much for the invitation to the conference and to speak and also to stay here. I had a very good time actually in Bure, although people discouraged it, but I
would
say.
What about the
weather? It was good. I think it was good. Better than Prince. Better than Princeton. That's for sure. I think it was okay. But all right, so and I apologize to those of you who have seen, if not me, one of the collaborators talk. Okay. But somehow, what I'll try to do, since it's also a diverse audience, in the first part, I'm going to give some sort of more general introduction to the problem. So that could be boring for the experts. And then in the second part, I'll talk more in detail about our most recent result. This is joint with Yu Deng, who's a postdoc at Courant, Benoit, Pausader, and I didn't get the names in the right order, but that's fine, and Alex Ionescu. Okay, so this is the main. So in the second part, I'll talk about our most recent result on gravity-capillary waves. But before, let me give you a sort of more general introduction, talk about the models and the results that have been proved recently. So the general goal is to understand the fluid motion for a fluid that occupies a region that is moving, evolving with time. So a standard example is waves on the surface of the ocean. And this is a question posed by Laplace some time ago, where basically he posed the Cauchy problem for water waves, asking, given any initial disturbance, which is also localized, say, of the liquid surface, what will happen next? Right, so, and here you see two pictures of some two different phenomena where you, say, perturb maybe a drop on the surface of the water and you have create little ripples that will interact. That's an example of sort of a nonlinear interaction of waves. And here you see some sort of phenomena which maybe looks more two-dimensional, right? Okay, now if you want to be more ambitious, which I won't be in the rest of the talk, but the models that we study and the equations that I've introduced also describe, I mean, are meant to sort of make us understand more complicated phenomena than just what Laplace asked, such as, for example, how can large wave form in apparently calm water? These are reported. And so this would be some sort of questions about some type of growth, right? Maybe connected to singularity formation somehow. Or for example, you can think of models where you have two fluids, right? And here, the situation might be more unstable. One type of instability that one sees is, for example, if you have two fluids that shear past each other, creating some sort of formation like that. So these are very poorly understood phenomenon, although of course observed, and there's lots of experiments. And they can be modeled by the water waves equation, which I will introduce, at least in some approximation. All right, so this could be nice future research. But so for now, let's concentrate on, so what is the model? Okay, so we're interested in a fluid that is inviscid, so I won't have viscosity, and it's incompressible. And the fluid will occupy a region that changes with time. So I call it omega t of Rn, and n will be 2 or 3. And I call v, which is a function of space and time, the velocity. Right? So this is only defined for x in omega t. P is a scalar function, is the pressure. And rho is the density, which is constant for me in this more basic model. And the equations of motions will be inside the region of the fluid will be Euler's equation. Okay, so just Newton's law here, and on the right you have the internal force given by the pressure, right, exerted by each particle, by particles on each particle by the surrounding ones, and you have, you might assume, and for most cases one does, the presence of gravity. Okay, so acting En will be the last coordinate of space Rn. And the fluid is incompressible, expressed by the divergence-free condition. And I will look at mostly at the Cauchy problem, so specifying an initial data. Okay, so the data to be specified is V, okay, which has to be incompressible. And one also has to specify the initial domain. Okay, now the system is not closed yet, but somehow so these equations are, because P is recovered from V, at least inside the domain, by the divergence-free condition. Now, what one needs to specify is how does the domain evolve? Okay, so let's say, for example, how does the boundary move. And this is done as follows. So as the fluid moves, the domain is moving, and this is happening consistently. So in the sense that particles that are on the boundary will always say if this is the fluid region, and I have a particle on the boundary, at initial time, a later time, this particle will still be on the boundary, and the fluid will just evolve consistently with this boundary. And moreover, the way that this will move is in the direction given by something that's proportional to the normal component of the velocity. So if the velocity is tangential, there will be no motion. Otherwise, the velocity of the particles inside will push the fluid to move. Okay. So this is just expressed by this. When v is tangent to the union of the space-time boundaries. And there's one more. So these are, say, n conditions. Then you need one more condition at the boundary about the pressure. So the pressure inside is determined. You need to know what is it on the boundary. And now what you can do is either say that the pressure is constant, or say you can normalize it to zero anyways to match the atmospheric pressure. Or if you assume that you take into account the surface tensions effect on the surface of the liquid, one will say that the pressure is proportional to the mean curvature at say at the point x. Okay, so this is, so either you could have or not surface tension, in the sense that you might want to include it in your model depending on also the characteristics of the liquid itself, right? So, and water is actually one of the liquids with the highest surface tension. Okay, and this is, so what is surface tension? You can think of it as a restoring force, because if the liquid tends to bend, right, this will push up the mean curvature, which will push up the value of the pressure at the boundary, and so create a larger gradient, which will then decelerate the fluid, right? So we'll make the fluid tend to relax. So in some sense, this could be thought of a restoring force, at least on certain scales. And for example, you see that, right? So at the interface of air and water, the surface tension essentially results from the greater attraction that this molecule has with the ones inside the fluid, rather than the ones of air, which are less dense. Okay. And now, as the fluid moves, right? So you can have, okay. So first of all, these are the equations, right? So this is the system. We have equations inside and boundary conditions. Now you can have several possible scenarios depending on what type of physical phenomena you want to model. Okay. So you can have your domain omega t to be anything. So basically, I didn't draw anything, right? So I just drew some sort of curve, and the fluid is on one side and on the other. Now you can have the model with gravity and or surface tension. And usually we call gravity waves the one with gravity and no surface tension. We call capillary waves the one with surface tension and no gravity. Okay. Now the fluid, in addition, you might or might not want to assume that it has curl zero, in which case we call it irrotational, or curl not zero. Okay. And now, as I said, you can also consider more general models where you have two fluids, okay? And that will create, I mean, all sorts of possible scenarios. You can have a fluid that is lighter than another, right? So they can be one on top of each other. They might shear, and so on. But this will be essentially, if you have two fluids, you'll just have the same set of equations on the other side, essentially. And then there's just some condition about that the boundary needs to move consistently with the two, okay? So there's many possible things one can consider. But so what are the main questions for this evolution equation, right? So three main questions one would like to study are, first of all, the local well-posedness. So given an initial velocity field, which maybe is nice, divergence free, and an initial domain, which is also smooth or sufficiently regular, can you construct just a solution locally in time? This is a perfectly reasonable question. And we'll see that it's already non-trivial for this equation. Now, are there some configurations that after you start and you can solve maybe for a short time lead to some breakdown? Okay, and what does breakdown mean also? Okay, so how do we think of blow up in this model, say? And then another question is, once you know that you can construct solutions for a short time, can you avoid blow up? So can you put some conditions, maybe on the initial data, so that solutions will live for very long times, or maybe forever, and see what is their asymptotic behavior, okay? And of course, there are many more questions you can ask, okay? But so these are the three basic ones, and the ones that have been studied about the Cauchy problem mostly so far. Okay, so I start the suggestion of row one to start with saying that things can go wrong. Okay, so to try to understand why the model is sort of complicated to study, we have examples when things actually can go wrong. So the first one is by Castro, Cordova, Ferfman, Gansed, and Lopez Fernandez, which is the following. So if you think naively just of the situation where you have a wave like on the surface of the ocean, right? So maybe something like this, and this is a graph of a function, then you could have solutions where if your description of the fluid is a graph, okay, that might fail to be so at later time. So you might have a graph that is very steep, and maybe at a later time it will overturn, right? So in some sense, this description will not hold. But you see, nothing wrong is happening with the fluid, and the equations also will make sense, just the description as a graph would not. But even more importantly, the result about splash and splat of Castro, Cordova, Ferfman, Gansedo, Gomez, Serrano, and Kudan, Scholler, which where they constructed solutions where what you can have is, well, what you see in the picture, I don't need to do the picture. What you see in the picture, so here you have a fluid inside here where the density is 1 and the vacuum outside. And you can have, so this is a very smooth interface between the fluid and air, and nothing is wrong. You start with such a data, and after a short time, if you prepare, of course, the velocity, say, in a certain way, this will self-intersect, okay? So now your description of the fluid as being inside the region bounded by a smooth curve, okay, that sort of stops making sense, right? And you cannot continue the solution, at least in a classical sense. You see the topology changes. And this happens all in the smooth category. So there's a touching point here, but the interface as a parameterized curve remains smooth. Okay, this is an example that has been constructed. And so you see that if something is large, right here, for example, what is large is the inverse of the distance, right? But nothing else is wrong, then actually the model, the equation can stop making sense. But for example, if you had another fluid inside, okay, such a touching in the smooth category of parameterized curves cannot happen, okay? And this was proved by Ferfman, Ionescu, Lee, and Kudan, Scholler, okay? So this is an example of some type of breakdown of the equations.
Don't you get instability if you have the fluid with higher density above the one with lower density?
No, so if you have surface tension, it's fine. So right, so if you have two fluids, even just for local existence, you need to have surface tension, okay?
Otherwise it's unstable,
that's correct. And then for short times, you can solve, and it doesn't really matter, I think, right? So you could have the model with two fluids, except that this cannot happen, right? So you cannot squeeze the fluid if the other one is also incompressible, right? If the
can I make a comment about that, which is with density zero on the other fluid, so to speak, there's no way that one component of the fluid can apply any force to the other component of the fluid. But when there are two fluids, then it can.
Yeah, so you mean the of this fluid, right? This doesn't, I mean, there's no opposition.
Look at the second where the interfaces are touching.
Right.
It's at that point where one interface can start applying force to another interface. Before it touches, there's no way where one component can apply force to another component.
Yeah, yeah.
But when there's two fluids, it can.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, that's what the theorem said. Yeah.
That if it does apply such a force that it prevents the... At least it prevents it in the smooth category.
Nothing prevents it from touching in this case, in picture case.
You're right. Okay, so this is what can go wrong. Now, on the other hand, the equations for nice and smooth initial data can be solved locally, and there's been many works on this. So early works from the 70s and 80s, and I'm not going to go through the whole list, but at first, people so started solving the equations in the analytic category, then smooth, then for small data. And there's been lots of very nice contributions by Walter Craig, of course, and Schneider and Wayne in more criteria, also relating the local solutions constructed to other models, such as KDV, Businesco, maybe trying to understand a bit more the behavior beyond the local world position. But this is for small data. Now, the real big breakthrough came at the end of the 90s, when Suzhou showed that any subwavelength data By this I mean, say, a Sobolev initial velocity and a domain that can be parameterized locally by a curve which is of Sobolev regularity, can be solved for short times in two and three dimensions. So this was, and if you think that for most of the other equations that we know, usually the local opposite is a triviality, or it's something simple, at least in the smooth category, while it's not for this problem. And this is why there were many more works that try to improve on this and also give us a better understanding and cover many more models. So for example, this case, the case that she treated was irrotational, Christine Urlid, but had the vorticity, and then there were many works, David Lan, course, had very general results where you can add a bottom with very general conditions, and then more works, Shata Zeng, Kutan Scholar, and then people started thinking of, okay, what is, how low can we go in terms of regularity, right, on the surface, and so Stricker testing were introduced, and these are in the works of Christensen, Hur, and Staffilani, and Alazar, Burke, and Zuli have a series of really great works where they treat lots of models, so gravity, surface tension, and have the best results in terms of regularity. And okay, so then there's also works on two fluids, but I mean, beyond the list of people that probably are missing someone worked on this, I would say that the local poisson is very well understood, but not that well in the sense that there's no unified theory, I think, that really can treat models in very large generality and give some kind of simple proof that, you know, can be read easily or satisfactory. I mean, all of, right, okay. So you have to make some effort somehow also to go through the local theory. Okay. Now, the third question was about, and it's the one that I'm most interested in, is the question of long time or global well posedness. Okay, so what is the setup? So before I start writing down a bit more about the equation, so the setup is the following. First of all, you want to assume that the fluid is irrotational. So you have Euler's equations here, and you will add that the curl of V is zero. Okay, so if you think of this, so in three dimensions, it's obvious that you want to do it, otherwise you'll be facing Euler's equations, okay? And that's so this will be harder than Euler in 3D, and you don't want to do that. Now, in two dimensions, vorticity is transported, right? So in principle, it won't be something that grows, okay? But it will be definitely a component that doesn't decay, okay? And the idea here will be that if you want to control the solution for long times, things have to decay, and having a component that does not could be a big problem. But so far, this has been assumed. But you know, maybe in the future, right? So so especially so in two dimensions, probably something can be done, right? But now if you have, okay, so the second thing, this is one thing. Second thing is you want your data to be small, mostly because of the examples that we saw before, that if something is large, right, then there could be breakdown, okay? And it's also, right, a very reasonable assumption for what would see as a quasi-linear equation. So you want your solution to be small and stay close, possibly to one of the equilibriums. And the most simple one will be the trivial equilibrium, which is a flat interface, okay, which has infinite extent. And for example, you could have infinite depth. That would be a model for waves in the middle of the deep ocean. But you could also potentially have a bottom. And there's been some work on this, so I'll talk about this later. So now, in this case, so you will have Euler's equations inside. Okay, you think that you have a graph here of your profile of your waves h of t and x. Let's say this is x will be in R2 or R. So depending if you are talking about the two-dimensional case or the three-dimensional case. So your interface will be either a curve or a surface, and you'll be summing Euler's equations. And now the boundary conditions, if you have such a graph, can be expressed more simply by saying that dth is v dot, essentially the normal, times the surface element. Okay, so these are the equations. Now, if, so besides the reason I gave for the curl being zero to be something fundamental, there's also like some advantage in the description of the equations. So if the flow is irrotational, then V will be given by a potential, which is harmonic. And so you can reduce everything to studying the trace of this potential. So you take the potential from inside, restrict it to the boundary, which is given by this curve, so which I'm describing by x, h of x. And you can write down the equations. Okay, so the equation, so the previous equation, this one, since v now is the gradient of an harmonic function, becomes what we call the Dirichlet-Neumann operator. And this is Euler's equation, once you express it for the potential, it's essentially Bernoulli's law, restricted to the surface. Okay, so this is a short computation. It's already non-trivial, but you know, so these are the equations. And posed on the just on the boundary. So x here is just r or r2, and this is a system of two equations for the evolution of the interface and the potential. Okay, so now let's not think too much about the form of this. Okay, one thing you see here that the gravity and the surface tension are the only so contribute linear terms. So this is gh, and this will be sigma, and the linear term will be Laplacian of h here. Okay, so you already see that having or not having them has already a big impact already on the linear solutions. Now this is a time-reversible quasi-linear system with quadratic nonlinearities. You see it everywhere. Okay, since it's quasi-linear, you cannot use fixed-point arguments to construct local solutions because of the loss of derivatives. And one thing is that if you write it this way, but also any other way you write it, somehow the equation is nonlinear and non-local, just because you're solving Laplace equation from the interior. This is already from Laplace and Cauchy. Now, one can deal with the issue of the domain moving in a different way than what I did here, which is by fixing, say, a graph. Of course, if your domain is not a graph, you can do something else. But you can use Lagrangian coordinates, morphic coordinates. So you can treat this problem in various ways, but these difficulties will still stay. So constructing local in time solutions is already challenging, as we said before. And now, if you want to go beyond the local existence time and maybe construct global solutions, you have to, so the basic mechanism will be to use dispersion to control the nonlinear interactions. And now in a framework so where you have a quasi-linear equation and with quadratic nonlinearities, right, which potentially decay very slowly, okay, so in this setup you need to rethink somehow and combine and extend the classical methods such as energy methods, the vector fields method of Sergio Kleinermann, normal forms, and all the Fourier methods that have been used, say, in semilinear equations. You have to rethink of this in this different context. Now, let me make a few other basic observations about the system. So, first of all, it has an Hamiltonian structure, okay, as pointed out by Zakharov in the 70s. Oh, by the way, this is usually called the Zakharov, these are Eulerian coordinates, the x and h of h and phi. And this is called usually the Zakharov of Craig-Chan-Sulam formulation. And Zakharov observed that this has an Hamiltonian structure, okay? So where this is conserved energy, it's also the Hamiltonian. So you see here that you have gravity which and total mass. And this will be the potential energy of surface tension here. And this is the kinetic energy, okay, which corresponds to half a derivative of the potential because G is a self-adjoint first-order operator. Now, H is the only known coercive conserved quantity. Okay, so you don't get much control on your solution just by the conservation. And now, since we're interested in global regularity, I said I want to stay close to a flat interface. So if you linearize around zero, what you get is dt of h, the linearization for the half space, the Dirichlet-Neumann is just absolute value of grad, and here you will get minus gh and sigma Laplacian h. Right? So this will be the linearization at close to the flat solution. And so the linear dispersion relation, this I'll write for later, is given by lambda g sigma is root of g c sigma c cubed. Okay, and also so all solutions of the real problem of the form are oscillating waves of the form e to the plus or minus it lambda of the initial data. So now, as I go towards explaining our main result and stating it, let me first say what has been done on the question of global regularity, and I condensed everything in one slide. So the first result was Cigevu's result, and she showed that if you are in two dimensions, with gravity waves, no surface tension, then you can construct solutions which live up to time e to the 1 over epsilon, constant over epsilon, where epsilon is the size of the data. Okay. Then later, at the same time, Germain, Masmoudi, Chadat, and Sujevu proved that you can actually, if you're in the higher dimension, you have global solutions. And this makes sense because in more dimensions, you are conserving the mass always, but you have more directions to disperse. And so your solution is supposed to decay faster. This gives you more control on the nonlinearity. Okay.
But also sigma is zero.
Right, so this is for just exactly. So all of this light is for either G or sigma zero. And this part is for sigma zero G positive. I mean, the same result is also true in three dimensions, also Germain, Masmoudi, Chadat, but that comes later. Then in two dimensions, Alex and I proved that one could improve this result and actually pull solutions to infinity. And the reason why this couldn't be done before is that there's something nonlinear that happens a little past this time, at time e to the 1 over epsilon squared. And once you capture that asymptotic behavior, it's one of the main things that makes you understand the solutions and close the argument for time going to infinity. And then independently, at the same time, Al-Azhar and Delors gave a different proof. And Ephraim and Tataru had a nice proof of reproof of Sujevu's result, almost global, and then complemented it to a proof of the global result. And then Xu and Wang, so sort of Alex, what he did is he reproved this result by improving the spaces in a significant sense, which is he could consider data that have infinite Hamiltonian, so infinite energy. Okay, so in particular, removing a momentum condition that is implicit in two dimensions if you assume that the kinetic energy is finite.
Okay. But you have to have one of them different from zero, right?
So all of this so far is just G. Oh, yeah, in general, yes, yes, of course. Yeah. So all of this is for G positive and sigma zero. All of this here, right? And now I do the opposite. So now the results with G equals zero and sigma positive. So 2012, Germain Chadat proved that in 3D, indeed. So this is a harder problem. So in 3D, there's something geometric that is different. And so it's a really different problem. So, but they proved that you can have global solutions. Now in 2D, it's also a harder problem. Because the reason is that, so you see, if either you have xi to the 1 half for gravity waves, or you have xi to the 3 halves, okay? And so this is the dispersion relation, which means that waves with small frequency travel much slower here, and so they tend to hang around. And this creates lots of problems. So the zero frequency is a big issue here. And nevertheless, we were able to solve the problem, and also Ephraim and Tataru gave a proof of global solutions of with slightly different assumptions, okay? So this is all for global regularity. Now, so what I want to talk about is the problem where you have both gravity and surface tension, so and try to explain why this is really a different problem, okay? So first of all, so let's take the picture, and we said that we can describe the solution by the profile of the wave and the potential restricted to the interface, phi. And now if you, so let's just call u this combination, which is essentially the variables that are in L2 by the Hamiltonian, okay? So now if you give a sufficiently nice initial data, so think of a sparse data, now these are the more precise assumptions, so u has to be in HN0 for some N0 large, it has to have sufficiently angular regularity, so omega here is the rotation vector field, two dimensions, and it has to decay to zero at infinity. This is how you quantify that it's also close asymptotically to the flat solution. Now, if this is true, then you can have a global solution for the problem where you have both gravity and surface tension in three dimensions, so in the case of two-dimensional interfaces. Okay? So now, what I'll try to do in the next, at least for the next 10-15 minutes, is to say why this problem is different than the others, and what are the main difficulties, and then if I have time, I'll give some ideas of the proof, at least of some parts of the proof. Okay, so there are two major difficulties. One is that lambda, the dispersion relation, has an inflection point, if you have both g and sigma, and this gives you less decay even for the linear solutions. And the other difficulty is that if you look at the quadratic nonlinearities and the way they interact much more strongly than in the other cases. Okay, so I'll try to explain this. Now, if you don't want to think of the water waves equation and the local theory, a good model to think about is just, you can take just the linear equation and then add a quadratic nonlinearity. Okay, so now here, also the way we explained it, we added it in such a way that the L2 norm is preserved. But okay, this is, if I have time, I will discuss why this is a bit more relevant. But you know, if you tell me that you can solve this problem, then definitely you can solve the whole problem. Okay, so, and here you can think of this model, and you can also restrict, say, V to be a smooth function just by restricting its frequencies. Of course, it has to be real so that you don't lose the derivatives. And so this model has the same linear part, quadratic, quasi-linear nonlinearity, and you disregard all other interactions that are not so relevant, okay, and cubic terms and so on. So this is a good model to work with. It conserves the mass like it should because of the Hamiltonian. And now if you want to reduce to this, you have to work a bit with the waterways equations. You have to use the parameterization, in particular in the way that Alasarberg and Zuli used it, with the wild quantization. That's something slightly different, and you have to diagonalize the equation, use the good unknown of Reinach. But so I'm going to skip all of this, okay? But somehow, so you can concentrate on such an equation. So this is a linear part, just like a Schrodinger equation, which is slightly different with a different dispersion relation, and some quadratic nonlinearity, okay, of the form du squared. Okay. So now, what is the basic strategy in general? Basic strategy is the following for all quasi-linear problems, I guess. The local theory will tell you that the solution can be continued as long as it has finite H and norm, right? And the basic way you try to push the solution further is by constructing an energy functional, which is like your H and norm. Plus, you can put other L2 norms, maybe based on vector fields, which if you have invariances, okay? But for example, in our case, we only have rotational invariance, but not scaling, okay? Which you instead have for these other two equations, right? And then you try to prove some kind of Gronow inequality, like Cecile showed, right? And typically, so if your solution decays fast enough, right, or you're clever enough, then you can prove something like this, okay? Now, it turns out that, so to do such a thing, you assume a priori that your solution decays, okay? So you want to control the energy by assuming that the solution is already dispersing. And the way you do it typically is by some estimate of the L infinity norm or some other weighted norm. Okay, I'll get to this a bit later. And in the second part of the argument, you'll try to prove that assuming that you have control on the energy, you will prove the decay that you have assumed to control the energy. Okay, so it's a two-part bootstrap argument. Okay, so this is the basic strategy. Now, what happens in the waterways cases? Okay, so this is the linear equation. Now, if you have one of the two sigma or g equals zero, then the dispersion relation is non-degenerate, as non-vanishing Hessian, and you get the full decay. So d here is the dimension of the physical space I'm in, but d minus one is the dimension of the x, right?
Wait, so you have different dispersion relation between g equals zero or sigma zero.
No, so it's the same. The rate in time is the same, but the behavior at say small frequencies will be different. But say if fifth frequency is one, the time rate. So that's very important if you want, right? But the time rate is still full. Right, so C full decay, say for the Schwarz data, right? Now, on the other hand, if one of them is, if both of them are not zero, right, then you have an inflection point, and let's call this a sphere of inflection point gamma zero, okay? And you see that, so this is the dispersion relation, the red curve, the blue curve is this, the group velocity, which has a minimum at gamma zero, which is this value here, okay? And so, and therefore you will lose 1 over 6 over the decay. Okay, this is like KdV, say, compared to Schrödinger. Okay, now here you see one important frequency then is gamma 0. There is another one, which is gamma 1, which I'll get to hopefully at the end, which you don't notice, for which you don't notice anything particular on the linear solution, right? So it's something that will appear later non-linearly, but nothing is special here. Now there are two major issues with our problem, which is all the previous results on water waves and other that I know quasi-linear dispersive equations had one of the two following features. So either the linear decay was already t to the minus 1, allowing you to close the Gronow estimate more easily. And this is the case when you have one of them being 0 in three dimensions. You have the full decay. Or if you didn't have the full decay, you could remove the part of the nonlinearity that decays slowly. Okay? So there's a procedure that can be done called the normal form that removes the slowly decaying terms. And this is the case of the 2D models, both with gravity, no surface tension, and surface tension, no gravity. Okay, so either one of the two things was necessary, absolutely important. Now here, as we said, A fails because we have decay 5 over 6, and also B fails. And B fails, this is a brief explanation. So if you want to remove quadratic terms from an equation, you should look at how two waves interact. So let's say you take a wave with frequency eta and a wave with a different frequency, now I call it xi minus eta, so that the sum is xi. And this is their dispersion relation. Now, if two of them never combine to give you the dispersion relation of the sum of the frequencies, then, so if this expression is not zero, then at least at the formal level, you are able to remove the quadratic terms. Okay? Now, so if you have gravity waves or 2D capillary waves, then you have some solutions, but these are the trivial ones. So say, for example, eta equals zero, xi equals zero with the right signs. Okay? So that could be treated, although in some models it's a little harder. Now, if you have both gravity and capillary waves, you have lots of solutions of this. Okay? So there's no way that you can remove the quadratic terms. And you see this is just a picture. So here, xi is fixed to be 100, 0, just a vector, and this is the trace in the eta plane of all the solutions. Okay? And there's nothing special about this, it's some sort of ellipse. Okay? But so this expression, this has lots of solutions. Okay? So there's no way to do that, and so the mechanism has to be different, okay, to propagate, say, the energy. Okay?
Am I allowed to make a comment about that?
Sure.
Which is, the frequencies that go into such resonance relations that are forcibly bounded. So if I cut those out, it's actually a compact operator.
Yeah, but you, I mean, you, how do you, you can't remove them. I mean, even if you remove them from the data, they're not going to be.
I'm not telling you, not saying to remove them, but they result in a compact operator. I'll let you, we'll talk about it later.
Okay. But, okay. If you if you remove just the neighborhood of that, then that's fine. But you still have to prove somehow bounds on that, right? So and they have to decay as fast as if it was, right? So that's okay. That's the main thing that I'm going to explain, right? So you start with an energy that it sort of looks like the nth derivative of your solution in L2. You take the evolution and try to do the standard energy estimates. Now, if you really want to see how this behaves, you want to look at it's convenient at least to look at it in Fourier space. So you just write the products out and this becomes convolution in Fourier space. And so you have two functions with the maximum number of derivatives and then one more function. Now, as we said, if you're trying to do an energy estimate, these two things are in L2 and this will not decay, at least for general frequencies, it will not decay like 1 over t. So you cannot just put the absolute values inside and estimate. But okay, if you're not at the frequency gamma naught, you should be fine. So let me restrict when you are at gamma naught. Okay? So I can assume that this frequency is gamma naught, and these two are very large. I'm doing an energy estimate, so this will be like large frequencies. Now, I want to study the oscillations, because if I just put the absolute values inside, this is not going to be integrable, so I cannot apply Gronman's inequality. Now, so let's try to, in first approximation, describe U as a linear solution, so let's let F be the profile, so once I pull back the linear floor, and substitute for U F, and get out exactly this expression from before, which sums up all the oscillations. Okay, and now, so what do you do? Now, you can look at two cases. So when this function is away from zero, okay, then, well, we'll see what to do. So first of all, let's look at the two cases. So either it's away from zero or say close to zero, okay, for some parameter. Now let's think about what that is exactly. Okay, now what do? If you are away from the resonances, you can average because this will oscillate very fast. And in particular, if you do it in practice, you can integrate by parts in time. Okay, using this, you will divide by something that is vanishing, but hopefully you gain more by integrating by parts in time. So for example, if this was a linear solution, ds of it will just be, if it was a linear solution, this is just initial data, so ds will be zero. Okay? So you are dividing by something, but supposedly gaining because ds of f is a quadratic expression. Okay? So there's many issues associated to this, but this can be done. So you're dividing by something that it's possibly small, but if it's not smaller, say, than t to the minus 5 over 6, the extra function you gain, right, should at least make you think that this is okay. All right? Now, if you instead are close to the resonance set, what can you do? Right? So let's think about it this way. If you were close 1 over t, right, and this was a function with gradient 1, then this is the sublevel set of, and the measure will be 1 over t, right? So you will be able to integrate that. Now, of course, you don't want to be that close, otherwise you wouldn't gain on the other side, okay? So there has to be something special, some extra oscillation that you have to be able to extract. And this comes from the following lemma, okay? So for this type of reintegral operator. So this is exactly the same expression that I have here. So I think of this guy, I take it in L2, and then I have an operator acting on an L2 function with such a kernel, where I have an oscillating factor like this, t goes to infinity, and I restrict the oscillation, the oscillating function phi, to being less than some parameter. And moreover, you can restrict to being close to gamma naught for that, for this function, right? Now, the statement is the following. If, and this is a simplified version of the statement, if you are close t to the minus 2/3, say, to the zero set, to the resonances, then this operator decays like 1 over t, which is what you want to close the Gronow estimate, okay? And as I said before, let's think again. If this is just a regular smooth function, and you're looking at the sublevel set of, so here is the, use this. Right, so here is your resonant set, which is just some sort of ellipse, right? And then you want to cut close to it, right? So this is of width 2 to the p. Then if you just have a smooth function, right, which says non-degenerate with gradient non-zero, then the measure of this set will just be 2 to the p, right? But this is saying that actually what you get is more than that, okay? So this is the main thing. Now, the proof is based on a TT star argument, sort of similar to how you prove the standard L2 bound for non-degenerate free integral operators, which have non-degenerate Hessian, okay? And, but it cannot be done that way, because this is sort of a rough function, okay? So it's a cutoff that cuts very narrow, okay? And what one finds is that one has to study not just the Hessian, but the Hessian of this, so this Hessian is the same Hessian as the Hessian of phi, restricted to some specific directions. Why you want to restrict to this direction? You see that if you want to integrate by parts, you don't want to integrate in the direction, so you don't want to integrate in the direction that it's gonna, where the function, where this function is not smooth, okay? So you want to integrate in the direction that is tangential, which is the direction of the gradient perp of phi, right? And this was already, some, an earlier version appeared already in the work on 2D order Maxwell by Deng, Ionescu and Pausader. Now I'm gonna skip the proof. No? That's why I want it. Very nice. I hoped I would use this.
You have 3 more minutes.
Okay, 3 minutes, I can do 6 slides. No, I'm fine, no, I mean, this I'll skip also. I'll skip also, so I'll go to here. So in 6 minutes I'm gonna, so okay, so first of all, with that and many other things, you can, close the energy estimates. Okay, so that was one of the main ideas. There's other structural things that are very important about the equation, which I skipped here. So, if I have time, we'll see. So, but okay, so you can close the energy estimate. Now, this is the first part of the argument. Second part will be, now you have to reprove everything that you assumed about the function decaying and being localized in space and so on, right? And you don't have vector fields, enough vector fields to say that the energy of the vector fields is enough to give you the decay, right? Okay, so in particular, you want to prove that the solution decays, and you want to control some weighted norm that guarantees that. Now, the very general basic approach is the following. Again, you look at an equation of this form, you write it, you write Duhamel's formula. Now you can do it because you don't care about the loss of derivatives, and you write it in Fourier space. So this is exactly the same as I did before. You have the product, it's a convolution, and you extract the oscillations. Now, if phi is not zero, that would be okay, but we said that there's many solutions. On the other hand, here, you also can resort, since you're not at the level of the highest number of derivatives, you could resort to integration by parts in eta, okay? So, exploiting the fact that the f hat, for example, you can think of them being Schwarz functions or being smooth, so you can take derivatives of them, okay? With respect to the frequency variable. Okay, so the real obstruction to not being able to prove that your solution disperses is if you have no oscillation, so if phi is equal to zero and the gradient at the same time is equal to zero. And this is the basic approach that was put forward by Germain, Massoud, and Chatin, and very successful in water waves problem before. Now, in this problem, unlike in all the other water waves problem, there's the following issue that if you look at this phase, it has a large set of zeros, And if you intersect it with the gradient, you'll also find that this is a codimension one says. So it will be of the form eta has to be xi over 2 for the gradient to be 0. And there's also another solution which gets discarded. But if you also want the phase to be 0, xi has to be of length gamma 1. Okay? And this was the other special frequency that I sort of hinted at before. Now, what happens? So let's say that we look at this expression and we want to understand how it behaves for very large times. Okay, and then from there, get some intuition on what is the space that we are actually allowed to put the solution in and see if we can actually prove the dispersion that we assumed before. So let's look at this expression and let's call 2 to the m the time parameter, just as a parameter. Okay, and then how does this behave? So if either the phase of the gradient are not zero, you can supposedly get decay. Okay, assume that, for example, you're a fat as sparse functions. Okay. So you can restrict by this stationary phase heuristic that give you the oscillations to a set where phi is quite small, like say 1 over the time parameter, and where the gradient is more like 1 over the root of the time parameter. And if you calculate just formally what this gives you, it gives you that the output of such an expression will be a smooth function that is localized on an annulus around exactly this resonant set. Now I'm just going to use the same picture, okay, of width 1 over t, or 2 to the minus m, 1 over s. Okay, so if you input sparse functions and do this stationary phase heuristic, you get such a function. So whatever space you want to put your solution in, it has to contain this, right? So you want all sparse functions to be in your space. You want functions that are Fourier transform that is supported on this thin annulus. And you also want your norm to be strong enough to give you the decay. Right, so typically that would be, for example, that one norm would work, but of course it doesn't work with this. Okay, so typically you want a weighted norm, something like an L2 norm with some weight on top of it. But a weight for your function means a derivative for this guy. And this guy is quite rough. Okay, but if you take a derivative, you see that it actually behaves, right, and take the L2 norm, it behaves like the square root of the distance from this sphere of resonance. And so if you take such a function, it will be in such a space, modulo plus or minus small losses. And so a natural choice where to put your function and prove your bootstrap will be to have dxi of f hat, which is like x on the real side, and degenerates has the root of the distance to this frequency that appears non-linearly as the output of all the resonances. Okay. And this was one way to deal with these norms, I mean, one way to actually implement this, a good way to do it is to decompose in atoms that are localized in frequency and in space. And here, in this case, you would also have to decompose depending on the distance from the sphere. And then to control this norm, it's a quite involved argument because you have bilinear terms. And for those you can maybe use, for some of them, you can use the heuristics from the stationary phase. And then when you are in non-resonant situations, you will have lots of trilinear interactions to take care of. And you have bad frequencies at gamma naught, where you have not enough decay. At gamma 1, where you have not enough localizations with degenerates. And so controlling all of this is quite involved, but so can be done. And this will close the bootstrap of the weighted norm, which together with energy gives you the global existence result. Now, I think I can stop. I don't know what that's here. Yeah, I can stop here. I think. Yeah.
So, if you look at the scattering data at infinity for f, it should have a singularity at xi equals gamma 1.
Yeah.
Right? Can you say what this singularity looks like?
So, I think maybe this is the next slide I had. But so you're thinking that. Right, so basically, what happens, for example, is that if you look at f hat or u hat, then this will be. This will be, so for some solutions, right, unless you restrict something about the support in frequency space, you will have that this grows like log t, right? Because, so say, well, okay, maybe, I don't know if this is what you meant, right? But say this, right? So if you look at the stationary phase, say, in eta, you will get something like 1 over t. These are the two things that interact, are xi over 2 and xi over 2.
But right. If you put t equals infinity, then
f hat at infinity, it's going to have a logarithmic singularity.
Right. If you're right, exactly. If you're close to gamma one, if at gamma one, right. Yeah. And then you can also quantify that. So depending on, so exactly in such a neighborhood of gamma one of width one over t, right. So you can quantify. Yeah, exactly. So this will be the scale. And also for the, you see, also delta norm, right? So also delta norm degenerates. Yeah, so this, I guess this what you.
Any other questions? It means we have half an hour. Great. Thank you so much.